So we'll start off, sir.
Okay.
Very warm good evening to all the construction professionals who have logged in, and good evening to you, sir, for having accepted, and thank you for having accepted our invitation to be a part of the webinar series that we have. In fact, Ramco Cements has been organizing this webinar series during the past 20 days, and we had number of feedback from various construction professionals, and future webinars are also in place, and we have planned for number of webinars in the days to come. Now, with those words, let me just take the privilege of introducing the speaker of the day, Dr. N. Ganesan, a former professor and head Department of Civil Engineering, National Institute of Technology, Calicut. In fact, he doesn't need any introduction because he's a well-known speaker in many of the conferences, and he has been associated with NIT Calicut for quite a number of years. He has also guided many students in the PhD research works in concrete technology and other areas. He has completed his graduation from Madurai University, and after that he completed his post-graduation and doctorate from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And with that, after that he had a rich experience of in NIT Calicut. So with those few words, let us listen to the speaker of the day today, Dr. N. Ganesan, former professor at Department of Civil Engineering, National Institute of Technology, Calicut. Over to you, sir, for the presentation on ferrocement and its application in the construction industry.
Thank you, Mr. Anil Kumar, for the introduction. And first of all, I would like to thank the Ramco Cements, then Anil Kumar, Srinidhi, and all people for inviting me to deliver this talk. I hope my voice is clear to all of you.
Yeah, voice is clear. It is
and
good.
my slides are visible.
Slide
there
is visible.
For
Yes,
important
it is.
As a speaker,
Yeah.
the minimum courtesy you have to show the participants. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Then let me start the topic. The topic is ferrocement. And you know, that's a very important composite, and a lot of developments are taking place in this area. Then I thought I'll begin this ferrocement and applications in the construction. My talk consists of two parts. First is to introduce ferrocement. What is ferrocement? And followed by applications in the building industry and the building component. Followed by another very important area, that is a rehabilitation. So that's what I have planned. So let me proceed with that. First of all, when we ask this question, what is ferrocement? When you look at, there are several committees. Our ACI committee 549, which indicates that the ferrocement is a type of thin wall reinforced concrete construction, where usually a hydraulic cement is reinforced with the layers of continuous and relatively small diameter mesh. Mesh may be made of metallic material or any other suitable material. Or I can say that it is another form of arthritis. When we teach students, we tell them there's an younger generation of arthritis. In fact, when you look at the history, the first application of ferrocement itself is arthritis. Anyway, we'll come to that. We hear that cement mortar, the composite is a cement mortar, which is reinforced with the layers of wire mesh. Maybe two layer, three layer, four layers, that all depend on the design requirements. When you look at this third point, that the uniform distribution of reinforcement, because in ferrocement, the reinforcement is uniformly distributed, and this improves several engineering properties of ferrocement. When I said several properties, the foremost is the tensile and flexural strength of ferrocement, followed by the fracture properties, that is crack resistant properties. Toughness, ferrocement is having a very tough, that is a toughness is very high, that impact resistance, high impact resistance. And this is a typical ferrocement section. You can see in this, that is the reinforcement in the form of wire meshes are seen, and this is the body of the material, that is a cement mortar composite. And when you reinforced the cement and mortar, where the wire mesh will be getting the composite, the ferrocement. Well, let us try to compare this ferrocement with the well-known material that is reinforced cement concrete. When you take this, the thickness of ferrocement is roughly an inch, 25 millimeter. And when you compare that with our conventional reinforced cement concrete, it is roughly 100 millimeter. Without the minimum thickness is 100 millimeter. Matrix for ferrocement is cement, sand, water. RCC is concrete. The reinforcement, which consists of a uniformly distributed layer of ferrocement, and in RCC it is discreetly placed. So what happened, because it is thickness is small and by more number of layers of wire mesh are there, if the percentage of reinforcement in ferrocement is about 10 times that of RCC. So because of this property, what happened, we have a very good crack resisting capacity of this member. Of course, cracks will develop, but they are within the limits.
Yeah.
The structural behavior, when you look at the thickness of ferrocement is only roughly, I said, 1 inch. So what happened when you conduct a test, how to compare with the RCC, which is having higher value, higher thickness? The tensile strength to weight ratio, when you conduct a test on ferrocement, you will be getting a tensile test and stress strength you will be getting. And if you divide by the weight ratio, it's called strength to weight ratio, that will be higher than that of RCC. And superior cracking performance. When we ask question to our people, that engineers and professionals involved in the field of construction, will you prefer more number of finer cracks than a fewer number of wider cracks? Generally, we refer to a larger number of finer cracks than a fewer number of wider cracks because of the other problems like corrosion and other things. And in the case of ferrocement, very rarely a formwork is needed, because that is the reason for the cost reduction in the case of ferrocement. Well, now look into this materials which are required for making ferrocement, and I'll go directly to the application. The first is the reinforcing mesh, wire mesh is required, and followed by skeletal steel and the mortar matrix. These three are the components of ferrocement. The function of mesh, when you look at this mesh, wire mesh, maybe hexagonal wire mesh, but actually we call it as chicken wire mesh, weld wire mesh, or mesh, expanded metal mesh, etc. And in the case of skeletal steel, the skeletal steel is required for making the framework of the structure. For example, if I want to make a water tank, then naturally I have to make the skeletal steel. Over the skeletal steel, the wire meshes will be placed so that the skeletal steel is sandwiched between the layers of wire mesh. So that's the idea. The skeletal steel generally to take care of, so the skeletal steel is to take care of the tensile forces which develop in the composite, and wire mesh is to ensure crack control. That is an important function of the wire mesh as well as the skeletal steel. There are different types of wire mesh that are available. Chicken wire mesh is a hexagonal wire mesh. Then we have the welded wire fabric, then expanded metal, and woven mesh. If you see the photographs of these materials, see, this is the hexagonal wire mesh. Normally available in the market, then they would have put in the roll about 2 by the half an inch, half into 22. Half means the size of the opening, that may be half an inch, and 22 may be the gauge, the diameter of the wire used. Similarly, square woven mesh, that generally the market which is available 6 by 22. 6 by 22 in the sense, there are 6 holes per inch length of the wire mesh in either direction, and 22 is the diameter. Similarly, square welded mesh, and this is the roll-up this mesh is available in the market. Then when you look at the mortar matrix, we require the cement, any cement, maybe ordinary Portland cement or PPC blended cement, whatever maybe that is required. Then aggregate is only sand. There is no coarse aggregates, and that occupies about 70% of the volume of mortar. And since the thickness is 70 millimeter, what happened? We cannot, the sports aggregate is not there, only sand which is sieved through standard sieves, that is 4.25 millimeter onwards, up to about 2.36, 1.1, and so on. Then water from public water supply, sea water is not permitted. And after the fabrication, the ferrocement composite has to be given a coating. That is, there are any tiny voids, and that is to be filled up. And that is in the case of marine structures, which need a protection against corrosion. And the coating may be vinyl and epoxy coatings. They are pretty used. Then there are two important additions for this composite, and they are very much required. Before I go to the addition, volume fraction of ferrocement. Volume fraction means, for example, this is the ferrocement section, depth B, breadth B, and this is one layer, another layer, and these are all the wires. Then the volume fraction is pi d square by 4. That is the area of cross section of one wire multiplied by m into n. M is the number of layers. One layer, here in this case, two layers, and n is the number of wires. So you can see the how many wires are there, divided by the area of cross section B into D, and that is called the volume fraction, and that is very much required for determining the strength of the member. Similarly, another very important term associated with this ferrocement is specific surface, SP. That is the area of pi d n m. Pi d means the diameter, area in the one circumference of that bar wire, multiplied by number of layers and number of wires, divided by b into d, area of cross section. You will get millimeter per millimeter square. And these two terms, VRL, volume fraction, and specific surface, are the two important parameters which are required while defining ferrocement. Now, when you look at the history, well, it goes back to 1849. Lambeau in France, he fabricated a rowing boat, and then onwards, very little application till 1888 to 1942. Until Nervy, who is responsible for the further development, he built a 160-ton motor sailor, and then that was found to be about 5% less than the equivalent wooden ship, and the cost was 40% as compared to the wooden one. Nervy also built a warehouse, excellent building that I'll show you later. Walls and roof were only 3 centimeters thick, corrugated ferrocement, because he cannot have plain ferrocement because the thickness is only 25 millimeters, that is only 1 inch. So we have to go in for undulations, corrugations, in order to improve the moment of inertia. Then onwards, it is a wide acceptance from 1860. So many applications like the boat, the hulls, roofs, silos, water tanks, everything that was keep going. And there is an application of this history. And while considering the ferrocement, the two important things is so many things are there. We should design the ferrocement. At many places I have seen, people are simply having some two, three layers of wire mesh, and they are putting that cement and mortar on the wire mesh and finish it and call it a ferrocement. But that is not the criteria. Actually, we should determine the number of layers of wire mesh which are required by design, by the code. And we have guidelines. For example, AC Committee 549, IR 88, IR 93, which is the guidance for the design, construction, and repair of ferrocement. Ferrocement is an excellent material as far as repair is concerned. Repair, rehabilitation, and retrofitting ferrocement could be used very successfully. And the second code which I want to convey is a ferrocement model code. That was published by the International Ferrocement Society Committee. That is located in IFIC. IFIC is the International Ferrocement Information Center at AIT, Asian Institute of Technology, Bangkok. And when you happen to go to Bangkok at any time, you don't forget to visit AIT, because you can see a large number of models which they have made using ferrocement. But unfortunately, after 2500, the activities are not much taking place in this Sarojini Society at AIT. However, the models work, see. And this AIT Bangkok, they published this Sarojini Model Code, which gives the design rules and how to design a Sarojini structure, and that is to be followed. Well, we have our own society, that is the Sarojini Society of India, which is located at Pune, and they are doing a good service. And every 2 years, they conduct a national convention, and the recent convention, that is the 5th national convention on innovations in Sarojini, that is FS 2019, which was conducted at Nashik, Maharashtra, during 7th to 9th November 2019. That is work serving as a clearinghouse, and periodically they conduct conferences, conventions, and people can get details from that center. So now let us come to the applications. Numerous applications. When you look at the building industry, the roof elements, wall elements, lintels, beams, columns, and so on, and the entire structure. But generally, we consider Sarojini, which will be cheaper when it is done in the precast industry. In the industry, we have to fabricate the elements and bring it to a site and assemble. The joints are very important. Then only we can bring down the cost of the Sarojini structure to a great extent. And then boat industry, irrigation sector, water supply and sanitary, and excellent water tanks are concerned. And then comes the rehabilitation industry. Nowadays, you know, the rehabilitation industry is going very strong. I am afraid very soon that the rehabilitation industry will overtake the construction industry. That is the order of the day. And both the people who are involved in the rehabilitation, retrofitting and repair, and they are doing good business. And mainly because what happened, the mistake done by the people who are involved in the buildings, and I think they are not properly looking to that, all the buildings will be in trouble, and we need to go for repair. Then there are others. I love to just explain a tank, the Sarojini water tank. In fact, for Kerala Water Authority, we have designed several water tanks, for example, 5,000 liters, 10,000, 15,000, 20,000 liters. The Kerala Water Authority under the scheme Jalnidhi, and many water tanks they have installed in various civil stations and other places. And here you see, first we have to find out the size of the tank, from the capacity. You can choose any diameter and find out the height which is required. Well, using that formula pi d square by 4 into h, you are getting that capacity, and you can, once you assume the diameter, you can get the height. Then you have to design for the given capacity. For example, in circular water tanks, the major component is the hoop tension. And the hoop tensile stresses have to be obtained. And the reinforcement required, we can always calculate it. And this is a skeletal steel. And how many layers of wire mesh which are required. Now you see, this is the reinforcement cage of your water tank with the skeletal bars. These are all vertical bar and other hoops are there, and they are at a distance of about 30 centimeter interval. And over this, the wire meshes have to be placed so that the skeletal steel is sandwiched between the layers of wire mesh. Afterwards, the cement sand mortar will be pushed into this. So no farm work is required. In any construction, the farmer cost is roughly 1/3 of the total construction. And if there is no farmer required, it means we are reducing our costs to a great extent. And one mason will be sitting outside and another fellow will be sitting inside, and he will be pushing the mortar from outside, and the other fellow with a cardboard, flexible cardboard or whatever maybe, and he will be holding it and making this thickness properly. Now you can see one slide which is this is the how the skeletal seal is placed. For example, at the bottom, there is one bottom seal is there, and there is an overlap. This overlap may be roughly about 30 centimeter or so. Then we will have the the outlet valve and inlet and everything will be there. Then the measure of the test. You can see. See, this is the water tank which is under construction. You see the thicknesses I told you roughly about 25 to maximum about 50 millimeter. That depends. Generally, it is about 25 to 30 millimeter. Roughly 1 or 1.25 inch. Thickness is very small, but it gets its strength and stiffness mainly due to the skeletal steel and the number of layers of wire mesh which are placed on that. Both will act together along with the cement and mortar and make the structure a homogeneous one. Till in the case of when you do the real testing, what happened? Till the elasticity, what happened? Both wire mesh and the cement and mortar will behave together. After the development of first crack only, the steel will come into picture. Because once a crack takes place in the case of mortar, steel will come into picture. But for that matter, one very important thing that everyone should understand, that is when we deal with the cement, which is a hard material, the cement, whenever it is used, definitely we can say that the structure is bound to crack. And no one can prevent the formation of cracking in cementitious composite. Another property, put a blame on that. But what is the role of engineers? The role of engineers is to control the cracks, control the cracking, control the crack width, everything they have to take care of. And there are several ways of doing that. In actually our RCC, as and when the concrete is cracked, the steel will come into picture. Steel will take the entire burden and that will share the load. So same thing applicable here also in the case of corrosion. But here, the crack width will be very, very small. In the case of RCC structure, we have our own buildings and all, the maximum width of crack that can be tolerated is 0.3 millimeter. Here, the maximum crack that can come in the case of ordinary structure is about 0.1 millimeter. And in the case of water tanks, it is 0.05 millimeter, considering the leakage and corrosion. Even we can have a top also, it's a dome, something like a top. We can have this skeletal reinforcement as well as the wire mesh. Both can be put together. And here, it's a large tank, means we need to do the necking. Inside, the flexible box will be kept and the necking will be there. Yeah, this is inside. The person has to go inside and it's manually done. He has to hold a plug guard and the other fellow will be pushing the cement mortar from outside. This is something like a completed water tank elsewhere in the rural area. And this is one of the structures by Nervi that was responsible for the further development of corrosion. We see the entire structure. So many rips are there in both directions, vertical direction. And the panels are only this much, maybe about 1 to 1.5 meter size panel. And they are all supported by corrosion rips. Okay. And these rips, that depends on, for example, size of the hull, you have to design the depth of the rip and the rip has to be designed. And the thickness of the rib also are roughly about 1.5 inch. And the panel will be roughly about 1 inch. And this is the typical roof of a warehouse. And the ferrocement is an excellent composite in the case of structures which are made using shape abrasion. For example, you know, the thickness of ferrocement is only 1 inch. With 1 inch cross section, how will you develop a structure? Whenever any structure is developed, we should think of two important things. The structure should be able to withstand the load through its cross section, one. Second, through its form. So if we have a form which is obtained based on shells of revolution, then what will happen? The thickness required is very, very small. It's not a cylindrical shell in the case of a small shelter or whatever, maybe so many cylindrical shells which can be fabricated at the ground and they can be brought to the top and placed properly, and it takes less time. And once it is done, with so many shells are there, you can see the interior, the shell, one shell is there, another shell is there, in between the joint will come later. And the other things, for example, maybe a RCC or a steel or whatever it is for a another view of this structure, you can see the shells are provided. Another view with the section box headings. And this is top view. The shells are provided like that. And the joints, these joints can be covered with, say, for example, micro concrete or micro mortar or fiber reinforced mortar in order to prevent any formation cracking. When it is provided, but and it, when proper draining slopes are there, the rainwater will easily get drained out. And very another very important application of ferrocement is the boat industry, because you know it is having a very high impact resistance and the toughness of ferrocement is very high. It is a very successful application case for boat industry. You see the farmer in the case of the boat. And the skeletal steel which are provided, that depends on the hull that we have to design this. The entire boat for buoyancy and other loads, maybe due to the tidal load or whatever, maybe that is to be designed. And the skeletal reinforcement is to be obtained. Over the skeletal steel, the number of layers of wire mesh, maybe 2 layer, 3, 4 layer, or 6 layer, that have to be provided. So that the skeletal steel is sandwiched by the layers of wire mesh. Now this is the four that rocks are there, over that the reinforcing meshes have to be placed. So this is another question where you can see the meshes which are provided. See, they are all contributing, imparting the stiffness and the strength of the deck. Then the outside, the entire, now the entire boat is completely covered with the wire mesh and the toughness is very high. Now final touch is given, because binding wire may be required in order to tie the wire mesh along with the skeletal steel at several points. After that, the preventing binding wire has to be cut off. Okay, now the boat is ready for launch. So this is one of the area where this is very successful. Then we have other applications like umbrella type, this is a parabolic hyperbolic we can use for making these ferrocement structures. Then we have the dome shells for those are excellent applications, and we can have a small as well as large dome shells in ferrocement, and that will come for a long time because of the presence of meshes which is continuously over the dome, and that take care of any type of cracking, maybe due to structural cracking and non-structural cracking. Everything taken care of. Then there were around household items like cupboards in the places, for example, timber or whatever. When you provide ferrocement, they look it will carry more load as well as come for a long time. Then the heavy duty manual covers, as I told you, it is having a high impact resistance. It is an excellent material in the case of manhole covers. Well, this is, I told you, it is not various shell separation. You see, they are having a dome and then this shape, idea, and architect has drawn the various shapes which are there, and they are all obtained based on a shell of revolution. Maybe a dome or a conical dome or a spherical dome or whatever maybe. And when you fabricate a structure based on this type of shells and revolution, what happens? That takes care of the load. It will resist the load by the form. Form means its shape. Shape takes care of so much amount of loading. And then the cross section comes into picture. When it is when you compare with our conventional RCC, for example, we have a slab, maybe intermediate floor slab or roof slab. The cross section slab shares some load, okay, major load, and there is no shape to come into picture, it's a flat one, and in this case that the form shares part of the load, and any structure which is made based on this type of configuration will take care of that loading also. So the idea is make so many such modules and assemble this module So what happened, you will be getting the tenement or the house which is required. Give an example, so many modules are there and they're all made because the thickness is only 1 inch, so we are going for shelter regulation, and the modules are arranged, so it will be a modular housing scheme. We'll get, of course, we'll have a, what is called a curved modules inside. They're all curved and you see the thickness is only 1 inch. So you cannot have a flat or straight one with a 1 inch thick element. We had going for so many undulations and all. So it's an intermediate view. The shape takes care. For example, this shape, round shape. It is not a straight one. It is a round. So what will happen? In this case, the equivalent moment of inertia of the composite is higher. Similarly, this side, all shapes are coming. Whatever the shape which we have to properly provide. And we see there is a model where these modules are arranged in such a way. Maybe a car course or interior and so on. Annual modular. And you know, the ferrocement is about 25 millimeter thick. So you may ask the question, what happened to the thermal comfort? Well, it will be very, very hot when you stay inside. That is to be properly addressed. In this case, the turf is grown over the modular housing in order to take care of. In other areas, for example, we may have to provide some sort of fast ceiling to take care of the heat. In another thing, you see the ferrocement dome house. This is a reinforcement, what is called, given that is a meridional reinforcement as well as hoop reinforcement. And the meridional reinforcement take care of the meridional dust, and the hoop reinforcement take care of the hoop tension. And if you can fabricate a spherical dome so that the angle subtended at the center, if it is 51 degree, the entire dome will be under compression. And when it is fully under compression, we require only a thin material, thin section, because the cement mortar is very good as far as compression is concerned. And whenever tension comes, then only the real problem comes into picture. So this is a dome which is made as a special dome, and this dome house after the finish. You can get anything using ferrocement that will come for a long time. In the case of a park elsewhere, and the structure is the and the ferrocement door shutters are very popular. We have to thank the Central Building Research Institute, and they serve over a longer period when compared to the conventional doors. Maybe a single leaf, double leaf shutter, and panel doors, flush doors, panels with 12 to 14 mm flush. And the weight is roughly about 20 to 50 kilogram per meter, so slightly heavier when compared to wooden door, depending upon the shape. And no frame is required, we call it a frameless door. You see the flush door and the panel door and all these things. Ferrocement door shutters are very popular. That will bring down the cost of the structure to a great extent. Another view of this. This is a chemistry laboratory, actually near NIT, Calicut. We have so many schools are there. One school authorities, the Vedavyas school authorities, they came to us, sir, we are going to construct a chemistry laboratory. And when we calculated completed the estimate, we found with the wood, it was so much expensive. And can you suggest some materials in the place of wood? Then we suggest, where do you go for ferrocement replacing the wood, which is timber, which is required. And the entire chemistry laboratory was fabricated with the ferrocement shells, ferrocement top with the proper opening to keep the cement on. And only thing is the supports. Here, supports are only half brick wall constructed. And from here onwards, all ferrocement. And due to this, what happened? The cost of construction was reduced to roughly about 50%. And they could save a lot of money with this fabrication. There's a laboratory. another view of this laboratory. And the durability is very good. It's come for a long time because you know the frozenment with wire meshes and skeletal steel is properly given coating. For example, a proper coating is given, and it is free from corrosion and free from cracking, and that will come for a long time. That is why this is used at several rehabilitation works. Yeah, similarly, any structure, for example, is a type of structure which is in LCM Indonesia. They want to put up the structure with this opening here. And what happened, if it is a pure concrete, mean thickness will go up. And here the skeletal knots you can see. And over that, the steel wire mesh has been placed. And the structure was completed. And that has resulted in about 30 to 40% reduction in the dead weight of the structure, and it is so elegant with the higher finish. Well, I told you that so many other elements, like for example, roofing elements. As you see a sketch of the elements, and the top roof consists of the trapezoidal roofing elements. There are so many elements are there, 1, 2, 3, and so on. One element is shown here, roughly about 3.6 meters long. 3.6 meters long. The house, the depth, you may go to the perpendicular to this scheme, is about 3.6 meters. And this is a cross section. Why this cross section is given? Because thickness of erosion is only 25 millimeters. We cannot have a flat roof. Impossible, because it will be deflecting. So, an undulated section like that. It's an undulated section. When you provide an undulated section, the equivalent moment of inertia of the cross section will be high. So the flexural rigidity of the cross section is higher. So that can resist that load, maybe due to some load coming from the rainy season, the water falls on that, and people will work repairing this work and all. Everything will be taken care of. And here, this is a frozen cross section with a small projection here. This is required in order to have overlap. So when you go to overlap, rainwater will not go to the joint and it will simply get drained. This is a typical frozen roofing with the trapezoidal section. Any section, any type of section one can consider. So fabrication, our students are fabricating the trapezoidal section, and the wire mesh is taken. It's in a big roll. About 1 meter and 2 meter rolls are available in the market, and the grade of this is 1/2 inch by 22. Half means roughly about that is 12 point something opening. That the opening of the hexagonal mesh is about 1/2 inch, and 22 is a gauge. It is about 0.6 millimeter diameter. The wire meshes are cut in this slide, and the framework which is placed, and this is a fabricated reinforcing piece, and it is kept on the framework. And here we are preparing the mortar. Actually, there is a double purpose. We want to compare a conventional cement mortar trapezoidal element with geopolymer trapezoidal section. Of course, in geopolymer we are not using cement, and that way only this is used. And you see, it is completely fabricated. After the fabrication, they are all so geopolymers have been kept in the steam curing chamber for curing, and corrosion elements have been kept in the water box for curing. Finally, the testing. It's about 3.6 meters long. And the load carrying capacity was calculated for a 1 inch thick corrosion element in the testing machine. It can test up to about 110 load it can carry under bending paper. Similarly, corrosion steel built up I joist. This is a channel section. When you put two channel sections placed to back to back, you'll be getting an I section. In the steel section, for example, in the case of steel, the market, we have rolled steel joints which are available, and the maximum length is about 6 meters or so. And whenever, you know, steel is a high energy intensive material, and because of the global warming and other sustainability requirements, people are trying to eliminate steel requirement of steel. And in that case, you can fabricate a I section using ferrocement, and this I girder will be used in the case of long span structures. For example, if you want to fabricate about 10 meter or 20 meter, that's possible. In Indian Ship Science, we have fabricated about 8 meter and 10 meter I joints, and these I joints are pre-stressed ferrocement. They are pre-stressed because of a very longer span. They are pre-stressed. In this case, only about 3 to 3.5 meter long sections have been fabricated and placed back to back and connected by means of a nut and bolt. And here in the fabrication is going on. So you can use, the idea is you can use ferrocement for fabricating an I section, channel section. That is the idea. The I section, which is kept in the testing bed, and this is a large I section, which you can see, and the load carrying capacity is tested. Similarly, according to, you have a flat roof, flat floor, then two channels can be placed side by side, and connected by means of nut and bolt. You will be getting the flat roof. For flat roof, channel sections are required, and here the channel section about 3.6 meter long channel section is being fabricated in the laboratory. We have fabricated, and already tests have been completed, and this is the long channel section. Mainly, again, the channel can be used as a floor element or part of I section. It is under test. We have being tested in a 310 compression bending testing machine with the proper supports and so on. And our intention is to just to show you the size of the element. It is not a small one. It is a prototype, a large element. It is another structure with an example, this type of channels and triple shot elements and roof at the structure. Then the ferrocement is ideal material as far as leakage is concerned. And in Malabar area, that which consists of Calicut, Malappuram, Kannur, and then Kerala, we have rectified several such roofs which are profusely leaking, formation of dampness, wet patches, and dripping of water. Such roofs have been repaired, and so same treatment can be given in the leaking pools also. You see, a swimming pool, the leaking pool can be repaired using one layer of ferrocement on the inner surface. The one layer may be a chicken wire mesh, no skeletal should be repaired, that will be fixed on the inside, and the swimming water will be placed. So leaking pools can be repaired, another pool, and this is what I want to say, the roofs. So this is a roof with weathering coats, RCC slab, and we have a brick mat cobba, the weathering coats, and directly one can provide a ferrocement. Only thing is, the ferrocement line has to cover the entire parapet. There's not any gap, otherwise water will enter into that. So the entire parapet has to be covered with this ferrocement top. And in this case, no skeletal seal is required, only a square woven mesh or chicken wire mesh which is required. It's something like we are covering the entire, what is called the roof, using a plastic sheet, and no question of water entering into this. And we need not remove the that is a weathering coat, that may be a brick mat cover or whatever, may be a tile or a brick mat which is used as a weathering coat. And so many structures. We have repaired about more than 300 to 400 buildings, both the Government of India and ordinary essential building and so on, using ferrocement lining. And till now, there is no problem. It's already more than 30 years or 30 buildings over, and they are doing good service. This is a very common problem in the case of that. When we have a what is called a depressed gap, what happens? and it is filled with water and the closet, engine closet is fixed. Water, because of the wrong may have put in the tiger or whatever, water will penetrate through this and dampen the entire RCC slab. That's a very common problem. And when you lift from the bottom, it will be highly unhygienic. Wet patches will be seen and damage and all. Under these certain circumstances, during the construction itself, immediately after the construction of this store, one layer of rosement lining can be given over the existing RCC slab. Then the sand filling and the fixing of the deposit and the tiles, that will solve the major problem which comes at a later time. Yeah, now the rehabilitation of the, so many applications I try to give, and there are plenty of applications, and I want to give your attention to this rehabilitation also for about 5-10 minutes. That is the how that ferrocement is used for rehabilitating the structure. Can you proceed, Mr.?
You want to take the question towards the end? You want to take some of the questions?
Yeah, we can. Shall we have the questions towards the end?
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay.
You can continue with the presentation.
Okay.
We can.
Okay. So, this is the rehabilitation using the flexure. An example. See, I told you that ferrocement in ideal composite for rectification or repair of the existing RCC structure. But in the laboratory, we cast so many beams. The beams are under preparation, and they were tested till failure. Certain beams have failed, full load of supplied, and certain beams about 80% load of supplied, and so on. Now you see the beams, RCC beams are tested till failure occurs. So many beams are there with 70%, 80%, 90%, and 100% load carrying capacity has been applied. And after that, the ferrocement was applied on this. And our stress columns side, who is dealing with that repair work, the wire meshes are wound on the tested specimen or failed specimen. This is the chicken wire mesh which is wrapped on the specimens, and the testing, and then it is plastered. And because the plaster, the thickness will go up by about 3/4 of an inch, about 12.5 millimeter. Then they are again tested. After the testing, it is noted that the load carrying capacity, even in the case of the specimen which is fully failed, that can carry about 30-40% further load. The major reason for this is the confinement which is obtained because of the wrapping of the existing structure using ferrocement, that improved. But in the actual structure, how would you do this the treatment? We cannot do the wrapping, but we can do some overlay. Ferrocement overlay can be attached to this beams and the columns, and the work can be carried out. These are all tests. Another area, the strengthened behavior of brick masonry confined with the ferrocement. Another very important area. And this problem, when we come into the picture about 15 to about 16 years back, when that Pala, Idiki, Kottayam belt, which was seismically active, went to a subjected to a tremor of about 2.5 to 2 point something. There's a very small minor tremor, and some of the buildings developed cracks. One of the buildings so happened is a church building. You know, churches are having slender walls, thickness is small and height is large. And that developed cracks. Then the father of the church approached us. Sir, what to do with that crack? And we have seen the crack. One method you are suggesting is, can I go ahead with another wall side by side? But that will look ugly, and unnecessarily the thickness will go up. And when he came to us, we thought of applying ferrocement. And before suggesting ferrocement treatment to them, let us check the ability of ferrocement in carrying the load. So we carried out using our the projects, so many projects we had, and Mr. Biju, who is fabricating the walls. The walls are constructed, and the walls are sandwiched by layers of wire mesh, this side as well as the back. and they are well connected by means of shear connectors along the horizontal direction and vertical direction. And the shear connectors means about 6 millimeter rods which are driven through the joints, and they are all connecting. And that we have tested in the laboratory with and without wire mesh. So we have fabricated this. For a matter, different heights, a small wall and a big longer height wall, everything is reconstructed. Different surface ratio were made, and the test was carried out. And surprisingly, we got a very important observation that in the case of ordinary wall with this ordinary plaster, you know that when the wall is subjected to loading, each brick will behave individually. In the case of ferrocement treatment, that is the walls which are sandwiched by two layers of ferrocement, the entire wall acted like a single unit, a monolithic unit, and that resulted in a higher load carrying capacity. In addition to that, high ductility also. That was the observation. So after that observation, we all tested one. After the observation, we asked the father of the church, "You do one thing, sir. You just use for that. You support the ceiling of the church by means of props or outer medium. Chip off the plaster on either side of the wall. Provide chicken wire mesh, maybe one or two layers on either side. Two layers we suggested, and apply shear connectors at an interval of about 40 centimeter in both directions, and use grenading to cover the entire wire mesh. Instead of ordinary hand process, it will take time. Use grenading for completing that. And due to that, what happened? The thickness has gone up by about only 2 inches maximum on either side, and that is giving a good service. So the confined brick masonry is an excellent example for improving the strength of the existing structure which is under distress. So that we have applied this at several areas for improving the performance, especially in the case of cracked masonry elements and so on. Well, probably this is my last slide because the time is done. It is a, you can use ferrocement in the case of structures which are subjected to some sort of cyclic loading or rotor loading. So the retrofitting of multi-story frame using ferrocement wrapping technique. Ferrocement can be used for wrapping what is called a distressed area, and the repair can be carried. For that matter, a multi-story frame, it's a multi-story, three-story frame with three bays and three stories were fabricated. And the height is actually a semi-prototype, I can say. It is roughly about 2 to 2.5 meter height, scaled down model. And it was subjected to loading in this direction as well as in this direction. That's called cyclic loading. When you apply cyclic loading, and when the structure, for that matter, any structure, any multi-story building, when it is subjected to gravity loading as well as lateral loading due to wind or earthquake, the first casualty is at the joints. The joints will develop cracks, distress, and whatnot. And the joints are not protected properly. The distress will extend to other members, and the total collapse takes place. So, when the joints are properly protected, for that matter, we have confinement. And in the case of column, we provide a large number of ties near the joints and beams, large number of stirrups at the joints. So, that will take care of to some extent. And that will help in redistributing the excessive stresses to other areas like this. And in this case, the frame was tested. And what happened after the testing, we identified the frame was tested. It is pulled and pushed back so that we had a beautiful arrangement in our laboratory. And this is the pushing and this is pulling also. So the joints develop maximum number of cracks. After that, the joints were repaired using the ferrocement, only a small portion, J wire mesh wrapping on an exterior joint. It is simply covered. Mr. Haji's standing is working in water authority, the civil engineer. And all the joints are repaired. And the thickness is only maximum, about half an inch. and the application of cement mortar, which is used, and joints are repaired. Now the entire frame is rectified and retested. After retesting, we got a very good information that the stiffness and the ductility of the frame, which goes up like anything, frozen and wrapping technique. They're all the joints which are tested after the rectification. And here, one important thing is, in the case of ferrocement rectification, we got a larger number of finer cracks, a fewer number of wider cracks in the other one. Well, this is this graph explained. This is a retrofitted frame, and this is a bare frame. Retrofitted frame has very high stiffness. This is stiffness, and this is cycle number. And it's a very high stiffness. Of course, as the number of cycle increases, generally it comes down. That's the natural thing in the case of the structure doesn't matter. Similarly, the ductility. The ductility is very important. Right? We have to design a structure, not percent alone. That is both strength as well as ductility, they are very much required. And all the structures, especially when they are subjected to seismic forces, they have to design both for high strength and high ductility. But high strength and high ductility is impossible. We want the, for example, high strength, the other one you have to sacrifice to some extent. But generally, we want to retain ductility. We can have less strength but high ductility. That will take care of the structure and can be subjected to a very serious environment. This is the energy dissipation mechanical also. This table gives the bare frame retrofitted frame an improvement achieved after this treatment. After this treatment, you can see that the improvement in the case of base shear, the strength is not much, about 4.84%, and the stiffness has gone up, that the initial stiffness has gone up by so much, and the cumulative ductility, about 120%, 12% has gone up, 112%, that's what we require, and the energy efficiency also. So this indicates that the ferrocement could be used without any hesitation in the case of repair of structures which are under distress. That is very important. Currently, many students are working in this area, that is repair and rehabilitation of structures under distress using ferrocement treatment and other material like carbon fiber reinforcement and other GFRP treatment, and compare all these things, how they perform, all these things which are going on. Well, during this short time, I could give some information. Because the ferrocement, normally we give or conduct about 3 days and 1 week class, right from how to design a ferrocement to start with, and finally we come up with what is called rectification tradition. With this few words, let me complete my lecture, and the time allowed, I will be able to reply. So thank you for your kind attention. Thank you very much. Any questions?
So it was very interesting topic, sir. In fact, ferrocement, we have come to know a lot of things about ferrocement. You know, it can be used in places of doors, designing doors with so much less thickness. In fact, one particular thing that I could notice from the presentation is that a very good laboratory is where, you know, where you can do a lot of work on rehabilitation before actually going in for that. Is a very good sign. Because in fact, we also have our research center, Ramco Research Development Center, where we are doing number of works on concrete and cement. So that's a very good thing. So coming to the question, sir, one of the questions that has been asked is, can ferrocement, can it replace waterproofing? That is one question. And ferrocement being used for avoiding leakage is something very interesting. So what is your views on this?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, thank you. Very interesting question. Actually, the ferrocement simply can replace any type of waterproofing, because you know that I told you, over the structure, when we do that ferrocement treatment, we are putting something like a plastic sheet, and that will come for a long time. Then another very important thing is this blending with the cement concrete. When we have RCC elements, we have already cement concrete. Ferrocement also is having cement mortar, which is blending. So what will happen at the interface, we have a very high what is called a bond between these two materials, and that will come for a long time, because ferrocement, we are using what is called a GA wire mesh. That is a galvanized iron wire mesh. That is why the cover requirement is about 2 to 5 millimeter. That will be enough. no corrosion takes place when you provide a proper coating, vinyl,
okay,
polyvinyl coating and all when we give. So that is an ideal material, and some amount of, for example, it must be coated, not against water coating at all, but this plays a vital role to when you want to reduce the expense or the cost of the building, you can always give. And I told you that many leaking roofs with dripping water we could rectify using corrosion material without removing any weathering codes or whatever may be. Straight away it was supplied.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Another question is that in case, do we need to go for steam curing? So what should be the temperature in case we go for steam curing of ferro cement elements?
Yeah, steam curing, that way the strength, about 60-70 degree temperature is required. Normal room temperature will be about 30-25 degrees. So up to 70 degrees will go. That will improve the strength, and quickly we can get the strength. That is the same principle we use in what is called an accelerated curing tank at all. Curing tank, we will make the concrete cubes and keep it for about 24 hours in boiling water and warm water and boiling water method. And we get the strength. Actually, we get some value and we will interpolate with the 20-day strength. And the quick strength is obtained when you have the steam curing. But ordinary ferro cement, we don't require any steam curing. Ordinary water curing will be adequate. But in the case of only geopolymer ferro cement, geocrete, we can say, or ferro geopolymer, because ferro geopolymer, because already cement has gone, there we have to go in for this steam curing chamber. Only 24 hours is required for completing the curing.
Any maximum span for ferro cement elements? That is another question that has been asked.
Yeah, the strength that depends. An example, the strength, the section thickness is only 25 millimeter. Okay, so for example, water tank, we can find out the hoop tensile strength for a given capacity. How will you determine the hoop tensile? We know the depth of the water tank, the pressure which is coming at the bottom, hoop tension is PD by 2. That is maximum hoop tension. P is the pressure, and that is nothing but gamma H, and D is the diameter of the water tank, one can calculate. And the strength will be very high, and that is to be designed for the given hoop tensile stress, the section and the number of layers have to be designed, it will be high. But when you want to compare with the RCC, the tensile strength you have to calculate divided by the weight of the material. There is strength to weight ratio. That ferro cement is an excellent one. And we get a wall, ferro cement wall elements. We cannot have a straight wall element. Thickness is only 1 inch.
Okay.
So we have to go in for some sort of undulations. There are so many shapes which are available, and people have tested also. And that will, inside of there will be some hollow space that in order to take care of the thermal comfort and all. Over the wall elements, we can have the trapezoid roof element, whatever I have shown, channel elements. Everything can be done.
Thank you so much, sir. I think most of the other questions you have already covered in your presentation, so it doesn't need any repetition because you have already covered. So thank you for that interesting presentation by you. In fact, we had lot of webinars during the last 20 days on blended cement, on smart cities, on how to make durable concrete. And there was a panel discussion also on the impact on construction, you know, this crisis that is happening. What is its impact on construction, on ready-mix concrete? Now that today we had the ferro cement as well, you know, it has added to the wide knowledge that already has been transmitted. So thank you so much for that. And we would be having some more future webinars as well. Day after tomorrow, we have one webinar which is being organized by, the speaker is Padmashri Dr. Shankar from Trivandrum, who would be talking about sustainable construction as well. And then after that, we have a speaker from Kolkata, Dr. Sujoy Biswas, who would also be talking about aspect of construction. In fact, he's also a celebrity who has appeared on various television channels. So we have speakers from East India. We have speakers from Kerala. In fact, you are the first speaker from Kerala that we had for this webinar. Earlier, we had speakers from Karnataka, a lot of speakers from Association of Consulting Civil Engineers, Structural Engineers. So it was a very good sharing of knowledge, especially, you know, for the construction profession. So with those words, I thank you, sir. Thank you for sparing your time with us and sharing your knowledge that you had gained over the years and your rich experience. With those words, I thank you for having spared your time, and we wish you all the best. Thank you so much.
Take this opportunity to thank all the participants about the patient. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you.